Hello, fellow Doctor Who fans, and welcome to a Kid in a Candy Store edition of Who on Who, the podcast devoted to the review of classic series Doctor Who DVDs in no particular order. I am, as always, your host, David Huey, and today I am the Kid in a Candy Store because I have with me on the show somebody who really needs no introduction, from Doctor Who Podshock and many other things, Mr. Louis Trapani. Hey, Louis.
Hello. Hi. It's a pleasure being on your show, Who on Who, and I guess today it's Lou on Who.
Yes, it is, isn't it? Lou and Who on Who. I love it. Thank you so much for being on the show. I know you're very busy. We talked several times about getting you on, and you and Ken and James are like the Beatles of podcasters, and so it's really hard to get you scheduled, but I'm really...
That's some comparison.
I'm very appreciative that you're willing to do this, and before we go into today's episode and doing the review and all, I wanted to take the opportunity to sort of talk to you a little bit and give you an opportunity to talk about some of your other projects, because while you may be very familiar to, well, of course, your listening base, and I would say probably 99.99% of my listening base listens to your show, or shows, as the case may be, there may be some things that that they don't know about you, or, you know, certain details that you may want to get the chance to throw out there. I know when you're doing your own podcast, you sort of have an agenda to stick to, and it's not one of those things where you want to say, well, you know, since I got this mic in front of me, let me tell you all about me kind of thing. So I'm going to ask you a few questions while I've got you here on the spot. Now, you are the founder of the Gallifreyan Embassy, is that correct?
That's correct, back in 1985. At the time, Doctor Who was very much it was very much on the rise in the United States. It was populating all the U.S. PBS stations across the country. It became very much evident that, and you would see it back in the mid-80s, the early to mid-80s, where it started becoming more and more evident at conventions. If you go to science fiction conventions, that Doctor Who would be making more of a presence there. And then Doctor Who conventions started coming around, and there were a lot of local chapters of Doctor Who clubs. And back then, this is before the internet became a household name and was used by everyone. So there was really, for any practical purposes, no internet that regular people were using at that time. So everyone kind of had, you know, became fans of Doctor Who through watching it on PBS, and but they had no outlet for that fandom. There was an occasional convention here and there, but on a regular, ongoing basis, there was nothing to do. And so there was definitely a need for it. And so back in June of 1985, I created the Gallifreyan Embassy. And at that time, it was called the Gallifreyan Embassy of Long Island, because that's where it was based. And mm-hmm. again, it was, everything was sort of, all the Doctor Who groups there were based in their locales, because that's where they would pull people from. So we would had, we had meetings, and we did conventions, we did pledge drives, and everything was based in the New York metro area where we were located.
Okay, now, before, like you said, before the age of the internet, where we can, you know, reach out and communicate with so many people, hundreds and thousands of people, how did you go about organizing a group and getting people together, I assume physically, into one place, mm-hmm. being that the only common ground they had was a television show they were watching on PBS? So how do you go about reaching out, you know, to them and getting them in? How did that get started?
Yeah, well, the good thing about, you know, having local clubs is that all the local clubs in the area knew how important what you're saying is. So there was a lot of networking that we did with other local clubs and okay. Newsletter exchanges. And so word would get out via the network of clubs. There was a Doctor Who Fan Club of America, and you can get listed there. You can use traditional, well, what we call today traditional media. There was the Doctor Who magazine and the comic book, and there were other outlets that you can put little, they would offer you a space in there to be listed, so you would get the word out that way. And as I mentioned before, doing PBS pledge drives, we would, as a group, go to PBS stations. The one that we mostly did was our local one, WLIW. Here on Long Island, where we did a lot of pledge drives, so you get great exposure that way, because that's you're hitting your direct market right there.
Sure, and is that where you met Ken?
can actually sort us out. One of the ways, again, finding people was I had produced flyers, and I put flyers in comic book stores, local comic book stores.
Cause, great idea.
Again, you're trying to find, you know, you go to target areas where you know Doctor Who fans are going to be. So he saw one of our flyers that I posted in a Doctor Who, in a comic book store, and he found us that way. And Ken has an interesting story about that as well, because at that time I had used my home address, and he was going to this Doctor Who club, and he was thinking it was going to be in this big, you know, building, corporate building and all that. And he rides his bicycle to the address, and he gets very disappointed and humbled when he sees it's just a house.
Well, it must have been a nice house, though. I mean, come on, right?
Well, it's a house that was it's bigger on the inside.
Oh, well, there you go. I mean, that, how fitting is that? Now, let's fast forward to, 20 years, okay, the Gallifreyan Embassy, 2005, Doctor Who is coming back, and all Doctor Who fans, big and small, myself included, and I would probably count myself at the time as a sort of a backbench mm-hmm. Doctor Who fan, were very excited about Russell T. Davies and what he was doing and bringing the show back with a big revamp and all that. And you decide to take Gallifreyan Embassy, which I assume was still somehow
yes.
active.
It was and, still going on.
And time. Take it from Long Island to worldwide.
Yeah, well, this was a perfect opportunity. With the show back, we were over the years of the Gallifreyan Embassy, there was a newsletter called Ambassadors of Life. I was, for the first 4 years, I was the editor of it, and then I stepped down, and other people had continued doing it. It was a printed publication that was mailed out to our membership, and that was basically how people, you know, stayed in touch with the organization, no matter where they were. So, come this time, we had a web page, but it was a static web page that mm-hmm. just offered information, and it wasn't interactive. So I felt now that the series is back, Doctor Who fandom, because also at that time there was a lack of Doctor Who fandom. The popularity, it just wasn't as strong as it was in the mid 80s. So there wasn't that much of a need to do. And there was Outpost Gallifrey, and there was just so many other websites and stuff that was filling the need that was there. But now with the new series coming back, it just seemed to be peaking more so. And I said, now is the time to bring back the newsletter, or in this case, make it an interactive website, which I did, and then start the podcast. And I met with Ken. Ken had already been working in radio at this time, so, you know, he had the chops and the
right.
you know, for it. So he, you know, and that we were saying, well, we'll do a half hour show. And Ken was worried, you know, how are we going to fill it with a half hour of stuff? And, you know, but obviously the show turned out to be much more than a half hour, and there's we have excessive stuff to fill up that time slot with.
Right, right. But still a very enjoyable show, and obviously you reached you scratched an itch that was out there, you know, to you know, make a phrase out of that. You definitely provided and fulfilled a need for Doctor Who fans on a larger scale than just in Long Island where you were. And from that point, I know that you are available, I know that you are busy with two other podcasts. I know you do the Hitchhiker's Guide to British Science Fiction with mm-hmm. the same guys, and you also do the Sonic News Driver, which I love because just down and dirty, quick, here's the news flash, you know, and that's a solo thing for you that you do. And are you doing any other podcasting projects right now or anything else?
Well, there are a couple other projects in the wings, so to speak, which they're hopefully will be coming out soon. And we're just trying to get – we're just – as we were saying before we started the show, sometimes people don't realize when you go into when you start a podcast how much work is involved with it behind the scenes and whatnot.
Right.
So since Hitchhiker's Guide to British Sci-Fi, as you mentioned, and the Sonic News Driver are both fairly new, I wanted to make sure that those two were standing on their feet firmly before launching other shows, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And once they're pretty much more on solid ground, then I felt it would be, you know, a better time to launch other shows than to overwhelm yourself with too many things on your plate at once. So
sure.
That's why there were a couple other projects that we do have plans on launching, but we're just deliberately holding back on them until we know that we can give them the proper attention they deserve.
Well, and I think that's probably the benefit of wisdom and the wisdom of experience here. Now, let me take a second to kiss the ring, if you will, because I have said...
let me clean this ring first.
Yeah, I have said on several occasions here, you know, publicly on my show to both listeners or however many I have at this point that... to me, Doctor Who Podshock is the preeminent Doctor Who podcast. It is the high watermark for the rest of us. And there are several Doctor Who podcasts out there. They're all good in their own right. But you guys set the bar. And you do it in an unpretentious way, but you do it in a way that makes us strive to be better, to try to, you know, still hold up that standard, because I've come very quickly to realize in the last 5 months now that the Doctor Who fans out there are the greatest fan base in the world. I mean, that these are people that, you know, I throw a podcast out there that's about Doctor Who and everybody is willing to give it a tumble. And they don't even know who I am, you know, and then all of a sudden I'm getting feedback from people and I'm getting, you know, support and all this. And I love it, you know, and the other nice thing is because of Podshock and because you guys are sort of trailblazers, if you will, a lot of the people that initially, you know, reached out to me and said, you know, a little criticism here, you know, constructive criticism, of course, they were all names I was familiar with from your show. You know, not you and Ken and James, but the other listeners who have contributed to your show or been on the forum or, you know, that sort of thing. So there was a familiarity, like a family sort of thing there. And that would not have happened if Gallifreyan Embassy, if you hadn't taken it from Long Island and pushed it out there. So, I mean, I, for one, who've never even been to Long Island, am grateful that you've done that because it opened the door for the rest of us, you know, and it gave us all a chance to have a voice or to, you know, to sort of find our own way, you know, if we choose to do it. So thank you for that.
Well, also, I mean, thank you for the kind comments. And I'm speaking on behalf of Ken and James. You know, we are always flattered when we hear that. You know, we do it as fans. We have obviously a passion for Doctor Who. And the one thing that's, there are many things great about Doctor Who, but one of the things that's great about Doctor Who is that it does have such a rich history, and there's so much, such a breadth of Doctor Who that's out there currently, and its long history that, you know, we can have so many different podcasts that are covering so many different areas of Doctor Who without even overlapping each other.
Sure.
So it's, you know, and we do the show one way, and, you know, there are other shows out there, such as yours, Radio Free Scaro, and others that do it their way, and each one is unique in their own way, and it gives listeners, it's all for the, I mean, the win-win situation here is the Doctor Who fans, because now they have, that not only do they have a choice of what to listen to, but they have a, there's diversity out there. So they have, you know, they can listen to many, and it's not like just retreading the same material over again.
Yeah. I mean, there is definitely a breadth of material out there. There's, you know, audio, there's the books, there's the comics, there's so many things. And
there's no way that we, as if, you know, if we were, let's say, the sole podcast out there covering Doctor Who, there would be no way for us to cover it all. So, I mean, we're actually grateful that there are other podcasts out there covering Doctor Who, and we just see it as a family, you know, and not as rivals or competition or anything like that. Which it goes back to, again, what I was saying with the Gallifreyan Embassy back in 1985, in the early 80s, we had a network of local Doctor Who fan organizations, and we never saw each other as competition. We always worked together. I orchestrated meetings with other joint meetings between our groups and other surrounding groups in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, that had their groups there, and we would try to do these joint gatherings together just to help each other out.
Oh, yeah, and 2 points on that. First of all, I'm going to toot your horn here for a second. I don't know if a lot of the listeners know this or not, but you not only co-host the show, but you put it all together. I mean, you do all the technical stuff. You do the post-production. You do everything. And I think the majority of the listeners probably do know that. And I'm not shortchanging either James or Ken, but there is a lot more to it than, you know, at least in the role that you fulfill for that. And I sent an email to Lewis. I guess this was a couple months ago. I was getting ready to record my review of Ghostlight, and my son, who's in college, wanted to at the last minute say, hey, Dad, I want to sit in on your show. And no father's ever going to say to his son, well, yeah, I don't want to hang out with you, especially, you know, when they're in their early 20s and the last thing they probably really want to do is hang out with their father. And I said, okay, great. I got to figure out how to do this. And so I'm scrambling, trying to figure out how I can record two mics because on the telephone, he and I sound almost exactly alike. Which can be fun when girls call the house, but that's a different story. And so I was scrambling trying to figure out, you know, okay, where do I plug into where? How am I going to make this work? I desperately send an email out to Lewis, and I get a reply from you via your iPhone, and I think you were even at Comic-Con at the time. I know you were very busy, and you and I have never met face to face. Matter of fact, this is actually the first time you and I have ever actually talked, except via, you know, email, and took the time out to go, nope, you're right, do it like this, but also turn this knob, you know, chant this, or, you know, whatever the directions were, and it worked. And so another compliment here that I'm going to heap on, and try not to sound like a total fanboy here, but you are so generous with your knowledge and, you know, not only your time and everything else, but you've always been very generous to the other podcasters in your forum. And, you know, when I've sent you an email and said, you know, help, how do I do this? You know, and there you were, you know, and you gave me the great idea of using the Star Wars clip with Darth Vader saying, you know, together we'll rule the galaxy as father and son. And so I used that, you know, on the podcast because I thought, well, why not? Here's my chance, right? So thank you also for that.
Well, you're quite welcome. I mean, as we've all been on the other side of the coin, so to speak, where we're asking for information, you know, and requesting help from others. And mm-hmm. So, you know, we try to give and receive, and I guess it's a yin yang type of thing, you know. But yeah, I definitely believe in one hand, you know, washing the other, or helping each other out whenever possible.
Yeah, and I've actually gotten a couple questions from listeners about starting a podcast, and the best advice I can give them is ask Lewis. It's Lewis at GallifreyanEmbassy.org. No, what I found when I started researching it was that there's no New England primer for doing podcasts. You can go out there and find white papers or, you know, forum posts and things like that. Unfortunately, as is true with all things technical, you know, 10 minutes after it's written, it's outdated. Almost.
Yes.
And a lot of times I read a great white paper on how to do a podcast, and I thought, man, this guy is it. Okay. And he's got it all. And every link in this white paper was a broken link because the, you know, the hosting site and all this stuff that he was recommending just didn't exist anymore. And it wasn't that old of a paper, you know, in quote real time, but in internet time, you know, it had been written eons ago. And so all I can tell you is that the information is out there. Have a lot of patience, and I will try to be as forthcoming and as generous with my information as Lewis has been with me, and I'm sure many others. But anyway,
yeah, so much has changed over the last few years. When we started 4 years ago, it was an entirely different landscape. And as you say, in computer time, years, you know, are measured differently than in, you know, offline time, because it was only 4 years ago, but so much has changed. And now when people ask me, you know, how to start it, whatever, and I think back on what we had to do, and now there's so much of work that you don't need to do yourself if you choose not to. There's so many different companies out there that will host your files, that will create an RSS feed for you, and not to get overly technical, but mm-hmm. will do some of the technical work for you that you would have to do all yourself just 4 or 5 years ago. So the industry has been progressing and moving forward over the last few years. So it's a better time now than it was before if you were to interested in launching a podcast.
Yeah, you guys started out with what, stone knives and bearskins, right?
Yes.
That's a Star Trek reference there for those of you.
I enjoyed it very much.
Can you do a Star Trek reference on a Doctor Who podcast? I guess you can. I don't know. I hadn't thought
we
about
it. We do it all the time.
Good. All right. Well, real quick, I just have a little bit of housekeeping. I just want to remind my listeners that the Who on Who website is up. Dave Hingley and brother Mike Hingley over there in Birmingham in the UK are just continually knocking the ball out of the park. They're doing amazing artistic things that I couldn't even imagine in my head, let alone get onto paper or on a screen. I mean, they're making me look good, which I didn't think was possible. So they are doing that, guys.
On the graphic artwork, that's really striking, the visuals.
Yeah, yeah, and Dave is the one that designed it. I just designed it on a whim. I said something on one of my shows one time. I had a very crude logo that I had thrown together with a face shot of me on a star field, and, you know, it was kind of corny, but I figured it would work, and there are not a lot of bald podcasters out there, so I figured I was good. And I said something to the effect to the listeners of, well, if anybody wants to spruce this up, you know, let me know. The next day I had an email in my inbox from Dave, and it was the new logo. And it was just, hey, he was doodling, literally doodling while he was listening to the podcast, and there it was. I mean, it's he's brilliant. I mean, I just can't say that enough. And he and I have become very good friends. He's, you know, we talk all the time, and he's always asking me, you know, hey, you know, can we throw this in or throw that in? And I defer to him because, you know, he knows his stuff and I don't. But speaking of, the forums are up over at whoonwho.com. And I want to give a special shout out to somebody who's no stranger to you, Lewis, is Darth Skeptical, who has joined my forum and has gone like only Darth can to fill me in on a lot of the gaps that I have in my Doctor Who knowledge, and has been contributing probably more than anyone on there. So, Darth, if you're listening, thank you very much for being part of the community, and I encourage any of you to come, you know, hop in the pool, drink the Kool-Aid, you know, have a good time. We're having a blast, so I'd love for you to be there. We have a little contest that we're putting out. It is a takeoff on American Idol. It's called Avatar Idol. Dave has once again worked his artistic magic, so go out to whoonwho.com, click on the forums link, and basically what we're looking for is for our listeners to vote on what generic avatars you would like us to have available when you register. I know a lot of us, you know, bring our own with us when we come, but we'd like to nominate Doctor Who characters from the classic series, and I assume the new series. I mean, we haven't really talked about it that much, but Doctor Who characters that you would like to see on there, and Dave is excitedly waiting to hear suggestions from everyone. I don't know if he's going to go crazy and draw or what he's going to do, but he asked me to plug that, so I promised him I would. So there you go, Dave. That's plugged, and check it out, please. And all right. Well, if there's no further ado, we will move on to the DVD review. You ready?
Sure.
All right. I'm going to set the TARDIS controls here to January 19th, 1985. And we're off for Vengeance on Bars. Hang on. This, again, is Vengeance on Varos. It's a sixth Doctor adventure. It's a two-part adventure, which I found interesting, and thanks to the info text, I kind of figured out, you know, or I didn't have to figure out. They explained why they went that route, but it's a two-part adventure. It's the Doctor's 139th adventure, starring Colin Baker as the sixth Doctor and Nicola Bryant as Perry.
It's a two-part adventure, but it should be pointed out that normally it would have been a four-part adventure. It's just that the episodes were 45 minutes long for this series. For this season, they decided to go with a 45-minute format as opposed to the 25-minute traditional format per episode.
Right. But, see, we still would have gotten gypped out of 10 minutes then, wouldn't we? I was trying to do the math, and I'm not a, you know, big math guy, but I'm like, okay, you take take 25-minute, and then you got 20 left over from that 45.
Well,
and, you know,
yeah, but then if you subtract the titles, the end credits, and then the you usually have the recap.
See, the light has just come on. See, that's why you're here, to help us toddler podcasters out. Okay, I got it. Now
we probably still got chipped a few minutes here and there. If on the DVD there are some extended scenes that are covered on the DVD, so you can get those extra minutes back in a sense.
Yeah, you can. That's true. Let's see, just running down the cast list, a couple other people of note. The character of Syl, who appears first in this adventure, but then later in, I guess it's Mind Warp?
Yes.
I have not seen Mind Warp yet, so I don't know what befalls Syl in that adventure, but don't spoil it. the actor is Nabil Shaban. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. And then also guest starring as Jondar is Jason Connery, who is Sean Connery's son. I feel kind of bad for him as an actor, because anytime anybody mentions Jason Connery, they feel like they have to throw in, he's Sean Connery's son, you know, as if that, you know, that validates him as a person or something like that. But I was excited that he was on there, because I know for a fact, shortly after he did this Doctor Who adventure, he went on to become Robin Hood in a British series called Robin of Sherwood, and he was it was similar to a regeneration kind of scenario. I mentioned last episode that the thing that drew me into Doctor Who was the idea of regeneration, because I love seeing how, you know, the actor changes, but the character stays the same, that sort of thing. You know, Darren on Bewitched and, you know, different things. That never bothered me. It seems to bother American audiences a whole lot more than it bothers British audiences, but they had I don't know if you are familiar with that Robin Hood series, but it was they showed it here in America on one of the pay channels. I think it was Showtime, and the guy playing Robin Hood, Michael Prey, Robin Hood died. They killed him, and everyone's like, "What? Wait a minute!" You know, because we didn't know what was going on. And then the next new adventure that they played, they had a new hooded man who was Robert of Huntington. He became, eventually, over the next couple episodes, became known as Robin Hood and took over that role. And I thought that was just brilliant writing, not meaning to get off track from what we're discussing here, but I really took a shine to Jason Connery as Robin Hood. I liked him.
In a sense, he was stepping into his father's shoes, you know, taking over, you know, that's what James Bond is all about. You know, he regenerates, you know, into another actor.
Yeah, so, I know you guys talked about that in one of the podcasts recently, and that just made me laugh about, you know, James Bond being checking for a fob watch, because, you know, he's really a Time Lord, you know. But I agree. Yeah, he is. And,
and not to go off into another tangent, but another connection with Jason Connery to Bond is that he played Ian Fleming in a 1990, I believe it was a TV movie.
Yes.
Secret Spy, I think it was called. And he played Ian Fleming, who's, for those that don't know, is the creator of James Bond.
Right. And before Ian Fleming was an author, he actually did work in Secret Service. But I don't think it was anything nearly as action-packed as the movie itself.
Sure, they took artistic license.
Yeah, definitely. but anyway, so yeah, Jason Connery appears in this episode as well. So I guess we'll start off with a little summary. I try to keep it as spoiler-free as possible, but I guess my first question is, the story starts out on the planet Varos, and I really enjoyed the setting of the prison colony type planet. I thought it was very interesting. But when we get to the Doctor and Perry, they're discussing events from Attack of the Cybermen, which I have not seen yet. It's not out yet on DVD, but it is coming soon, and I'm very excited because we discussed it when we reviewed Tomb of the Cybermen, that it was a return trip to Telos, and so I'm very interested to see how that all plays out. But the TARDIS runs out of gas, essentially. And I guess the first thing that kind of made me scratch my head was, okay, the show's been on for 20-some-odd years. That's never happened before. So all of a sudden, the TARDIS requires this fuel, for lack of a better term. Now, being that you were more I guess we'll call it a real-time fan. Okay, you saw this episode closer to the time that it actually aired than I did, because I just saw it last week. How did the fan base in general, did anybody take a second look at that at all? Did anybody go, it's obviously a plot device, but I mean, did anybody call them out on that? Or?
At the time, I don't recall much reaction at that time, but Zyton 7
or something, yeah.
Is what was needed. And, I mean, what was peculiar is that it was only found on this planet of Varus and all that, so you would think that if it had a fuel source, it would be something other than that, you know, other than just like this obscure little planet, you know. How often do they have to stop over at this planet to get it, you know?
yeah. And what's interesting is that we find out later on that, they are selling the Zyton or Zyton, whatever it is, to other, you know, organizations. So maybe they've got, you know, fueling depots, you know, somewhere. But you would think that when the Time Lords were building those things, that they would have come up with something more readily available, you know, on Gallifrey or whatever. I believe
the TARDIS is supposed to get its power from the black hole that Rassilon had harnessed. And if you go back to, I think it goes all the way back to the Three Doctors. And, and then, of course, in the series today, I think it was Boomtown, where the TARDIS has to land and in the Rift, which eventually will become Torchwood, you know, that general area to absorb some of the power from the Rift.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I guess he just sort of modified. He took it from regular unleaded or petrol to biodiesel or whatever the equivalent is. But it still runs, thank goodness. Otherwise, it'd be a pretty boring show. Although he seems reticent to leave Earth, but that's a totally different argument we won't get into right now. The TARDIS runs out of fuel. They have the other thing that sort of caught me as odd was after they've established that the TARDIS is out of fuel, the Doctor seems just kind of like, depressed. He goes, he sits down on the chair. He mentions to Perry, he says, you know, you're going to grow old and die here in the TARDIS. I'm going to keep regenerating, you know, and live out all my lives sitting here. And just didn't seem very doctorish to me, and this goes back, I guess, to my critique of the Sixth Doctor. One of the reasons I was really excited about reviewing this is because I've never been a big fan of the Sixth Doctor, but I've never seen that many episodes. I started mulling that over after making that comment, you know, about not being a Sixth Doctor fan, and I think it goes back to when I was first introduced to Doctor Who back in the 90s, the young man that was showing me his Doctor Who collection, he had a lot of them on VHS that were taped off of PBS stations. And I was, like I said, enthralled with regeneration. So I wanted to see the regeneration, and then I wanted to see the first story of, you know, the new Doctor, to see, you know, him get his costume and all this sort of thing. And I saw the Twin Dilemma, and I can't tell you anything about it except the very vivid image of the Doctor choking the life out of Perry. And that really threw me, you know, not because I thought Perry was cute, she is, but although now I have to tell you, as an older gentleman listening to her voice and her American accent, I may have been prone to choke her after a while too, but, you know, but I don't do mean very well. Peter Davison has always been one of my favorite doctors because he was nice. And he may have been brusque with people at times, but he was nice. And this guy was like a total 180. I mean, he was, you know, rather full of himself and, you know, a little off-center and that sort of thing. And,
yeah. Well, a lot of that was deliberate because John Nathan Turner, JNT, at the time, would cast and coach, you know, the new doctor to be a contrast to the previous doctor. So when Peter Davison took over from Tom Baker, Peter Davison played the role very differently than what Tom Baker did.
Right.
And just as when Colin Baker took over from Peter Davison, he went a completely other route, you know, where Peter Davison was more laid back and gentle and kind. And we wanted, and here Colin Baker was going for the touchiness of Hartnell and bringing that back. And also, at the time, Colin Baker, And he was doing U.S. conventions at the time, back in 1985. He was seen here in the States, and I had an opportunity to see him there. And his plan was actually to do the series as an, he was actually hoping to do it for at least 8 years. And wow. There was going to be a character arc that you would see the Doctor gradually go from being, because it was this rough regeneration where the Peter Davison's Doctor almost died, and this regeneration was going to be, they say this with every regeneration, but yeah. It was going to be the roughest ever, and so a lot of it was post-regeneration trauma, if you will. Mm-hmm. So, but he was going to get, and if you remember, if you go back to the first Doctor, he softened up over his time as well, where he was very rough and edgy at first, and threatened his companions as well.
Yes.
And then he became more loving and kind, and I think that's what Colin Baker was hoping to do, but unfortunately he was dealt cards that with outside forces that had an influence on the series after this season that really hampered on what they really wanted to do with his character, and what, you know, and unfortunately I don't think he got a fair shake in the end, but
no, I don't think he did either, and I was hoping to maybe discuss that a little bit with you, because I know that you and the guys on Podshock have discussed it before. I'm not as familiar with historically what was going on with the show, you know, outside of the context of the show. I know about the hiatus. I know about, you can mention Michael Grade to Ken and just stand back and let him go crazy, but, you know, all that as well. That there was a lot going on, and you have to almost feel for the people that were just sort of caught in the whirlwind of it and trying to do the best that they could do, you know, with what they were given. And, you know, ultimately, and this has been said many times before here and in many other places, it really comes down to the writing. It doesn't, you know, that if the writers write a great story, then a great actor can make it something amazing, but even a mediocre actor can pull off a good performance with great writing. But when it seems like the writing and the production team are all in a shambles, even a great actor like Colin Baker is going, and yes, folks, I said Colin Baker, even a great actor is going to have a hard time with that material. So I do feel for him. I really do. But, you know, I'll refrain from my
opinion.
But
what's interesting is that a lot of people that what we've, Ken and I, and I, the reason why I'm including Ken, because we were there watching these back when they were originally transmitted and aired, you know, back in the 80s. James was too young at that. Well, he was too young at that time. So so we've seen some of the people that maybe were not that warmed up to Colin Baker at that time, or have over the years grown to like him, because he's done other things. He's done the audio dramas as well, Big Finish and otherwise, and people have come to appreciate him playing the Doctor once he had a chance to kind of really flesh it out more so than he was able to do in the two television series that, you know, that he had the opportunity in the 80s to do.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think he did a great job here, but let's continue on and kind of cover the story real fast. They get to Veros. They find out that Veros is basically a prison colony, former prison colony. It's a mining colony that is essentially broke. They have hardly enough money to feed the workers who are doing the mining. They are trying to negotiate with an alien by the name of Syl, who is offering them a ridiculously low price for this ore that the Doctor needs. And so we as the viewer sort of know that, that it must be more valuable and whatever. And not wanting to get too far into spoiler territory, but there is a bit of a rebellion. One of the things that I thought was very interesting was the residents of Veros were doing their voting, and also what they saw on TV. Basically, their television was torture and executions. And I know that this particular episode received a lot of negative feedback for violence. There's a scene with an acid bath and all that, which I honestly didn't think was that bad. I was really impressed with the effects, given, you know, the time and the typical BBC budget for this sort of thing, but I wasn't really that offended by the violence per se, but I looked at this and thought, wow, what a precursor to modern day reality exactly. television. You know what I mean?
It's, a commentary on the media. Well, it was at the time, it was a commentary on media and the government, but even more so, as you said, it's a precursor. What television has become now, reality television, Big Brother, Survivor. I mean, that's what people are doing. They're voting people on and off the show, and essentially, you know, this kind of illustrated that back mm-hmm. in 1985.
Yeah, we seem as a culture, and I say we, but I don't watch reality television. The only I mean, I get enough reality on my own, but the only reality show I'll watch is Mrs. Huey Likes Dancing with the Stars, and so I'll watch that with her. But even this season, we just got to the point where the drama was getting ridiculous, and said, "All right, we're not going to watch it anymore." At least this year. But I have a sister who's really into like Survivor and all that, and I'm sort of fascinated on the outskirts of it, because I talk to her about it and I say, well, you know, people seem to be thrilled watching other people suffer, you know, and I just don't buy into the whole thing. She said, well, you know, it's interesting because they don't have food. I said, then who's feeding the camera crew? You know, because they're eating. I promise you that. And she goes, well, yeah, I guess. I said, believe me, they've got food. And she's like, yeah, but the contestants aren't allowed to eat, or, you know, all of that. And I just don't get the entertainment value of that, nor do I get the instant celebrity that a lot of these people gain with their 15 minutes, you know, that Andy Warhol talked about. Everybody gets 15 minutes of fame. This is mine. I'm running out right now. But, you know, everybody has their thing. And if they get on TV in one of these crazy reality shows, and so I'm watching them in this episode here, I'm watching them watch an execution and talk very matter-of-factly about, oh, we haven't seen a good execution in a couple weeks, and, you know, oh, you forgot about the blind guy. He wasn't blind. He was, you know, and they're just...
Well, not
you
at
know,
first.
Right, not at first, exactly. And they were just having this rather... It's like they were discussing the football match on TV or something.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't... There was no gravitas. There was nothing like, wow, somebody just died, you know? That was nothing to them. And that was the first thing I thought. I watched that and I thought, are we headed that way? You know, are we going, I mean, I don't want to get on a soapbox or anything, but are we as a society, is our TV going that way?
Yeah. I mean, it seems to be. Yeah.
Yeah.
Unfortunately,
it's shock value. You know, it's, you know, what more can we do kind of thing.
It's also a cheap production. They don't have to write, they don't have to hire script writers. It's, you know, the story editors, whatever. It's basically, you know, set some people up in a situation and let it play out and just try to make it as dramatic as possible.
Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I understand, I guess, from their point of view why they do it, but...
And it's interesting, as you commented before, that this episode of Vengeance of Horrors is singled out for its violence and all that, and as and if you listen to the commentary on it, Colin Baker points out, and rightly so, is that the whole point of this episode, the whole statement that they were making was... how you can get numb to violence on television. I mean, that was
right.
The point they were trying to make. And these, you know, advocacy groups and Mary Whitehouse and whatnot, you know, were shouting out how violent this episode was and pointing to that. But that's the exact point they were trying to make with it. And it just went over their heads.
Yeah, I know. And that's really, it's sad, but it's not surprising.
Yeah.
Because sometimes people put blinders on when they become passionate about something, and I never discount anyone's passion, whether I agree with it or I don't agree with it, but you have to be willing to look at both sides and be more informed. You know what I mean? And so it's sad that it went that route. But as far as the story itself, as far as the production values, I have to give it a lot of points for the makeup, especially. For Syl,
mm-hmm.
and for Perry turning into a bird, for Jason Connery's character Jondar, for his wife, is also being transformed into something bestial. I want to say
almost looks like a Klingon.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, you're right. A little bit. You know, not as tough looking, but you know, like yeah, something like that.
Well, she had that thing on the forehead that reminded me of it.
Yeah, she had that little ridge thing going right there. But
I think you're right. At the time, this was really, I mean, in Doctor Who, the production values with this episode was outstanding mm-hmm. for its time, and you can see some influences from the movie Dune. And 1984, that which was out in the theaters just at the time when this was in production, so you can see some of that influences on the textures and the costume designs. I mean, my only little gripe, I guess, with the costumes is that just like today's Cybermen from Pete's World have the C on the chest. The V keeps on reappearing on that costume. So outside of that, I thought they did an outstanding job.
Just in case you're in danger of forgetting what planet you live on, we've got the V stamped right here on your jumpsuit.
Because obviously everyone here on Earth wears E's on their fashions. You know,
you know what? I'm going to start doing that. I think that's a great idea. We could start something there, Lewis. Everybody start wearing an E. And when they ask you, just say Earth. I just don't want to forget where I am. Okay, now here on my show, taking actually a nod to you and the fine folks at Podshock, I use Cloister Bells instead of TARDIS groans. So,
See, we do that for spoiler warnings.
Yes, but see, I try not to deal in spoilers, so I get around that little kerfuffle there. But okay, so if out of five Cloister Bells. What would you give this? And feel free to expound on that. Why?
I probably would give this 3.5 Cloister Bells, and possibly maybe at the time back. You know, when any time I watch Doctor Who, I try to put myself back at the time of that period. You know, when it came out. So possibly even hedging to 4 at that time. Rewatching it now, some of the, as you had said, maybe I would have tweaked some of the acting or some of the situations that kind of glare out now, which maybe at the time I didn't really catch. So, but I think it's still an enjoyable story, and I think it is a good commentary and foretelling of what television is today. And this is going back to this, as you said, came out in January of 85, but it was. It was in production back in late 84 and so I think it did really tell it did predict where television was going, and I think it is a commentary not only on the media but also on government as well, and I think for that alone I think it stands out, and as you said, it introduces Syl, who we'll see again. I won't give any spoilers, but so he is a ongoing character, so to speak, so it plays some importance there too, but I do think it's an enjoyable story, and it does have some significance. So I would say 3.5.
3.5. Okay. Now I'm curious, because I assume that you've seen probably all the televised Colin Baker adventures, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Sure.
How does this rank compared to his other stories? Where would you put this? Would you put this near the top, or like in the middle, or you know, bottom, or I know there's not a lot of stiff competition with his stories, but I only have this one and the two Doctors that I've watched.
I would put this sort of in the middle.
Okay.
And because I think there's other Colin Baker stories that that are just a little bit more gripping.
Okay.
That will carry you through. I think. But I, to its credit, I also want to say here we have two characters that we are, I believe, if I remember correctly, the episode introduces us to even before the Doctor and Perry. And we follow these two characters, and these two characters never meet up with the Doctor or any of his companions. So it's kind of interesting in that way that you're watching other people watching what's being played out as well. So that's kind of interesting as well, because I don't believe you've seen that before in Doctor Who.
No, and the infotext even went so far as to explain that those actors, their role was expanded. They were supposed to initially be silent watchers, and they didn't even meet the rest of the cast except during the read-through. They weren't involved. I mean, they shot all of their scenes in one day in the studio, completely apart. So it even added to the reality of that a little bit. So yeah, I agree. I thought that was a very nice touch. I got to tell you, I walked into this. I put this DVD in my player and fully expected to not get much above a 2.5 just because I've said that, the Sixth Doctor is not my favorite Doctor. But I would honestly give this 4 out of 5, and I'm going to tell you why. Going back to what I said about the writing, I thought that the writing was good. I thought that the commentary about violence on TV and just the... You couldn't have predicted in 1985 that here in 2009, this is what we're watching. And it's not an American phenomenon. It's a worldwide phenomenon, reality TV is. So I thought it was very prescient of them to do that. And, whether that was their intention or not, it adds a certain amount of realism to it for me. I liked the Doctor. I didn't agree with some of his reactions early on. I thought he was a little hangdog, but then once he got going, he was willing to defend his companion, to do what he felt was right, to help the people in Varos. He also there was a couple of parts, and I don't remember specifically, where you could tell that he knew more about what was going on than what he was willing to give out, which is a trait of the Seventh and the Second Doctor that I love very much, when you know the Doctor's 2 or 3 steps ahead of everybody else and he's just sort of waiting for you to catch up. And so I did enjoy that as well. So all in all, this is so far my favorite Sixth Doctor story, and I'm going to give this one 4 out of 5.
Right.
So, all right. Well, there are several DVD extras on here, some more interesting than others, but let's go ahead and talk about those.
Extra, extra, read all about it. Extra, extra, read all about it.
Well, just to make a point, it was a 2003 U.S. release, Warner Brothers release. This is before Two Entertain took over, and the extras, there's really nothing that's really produced specifically for the DVD,
right,
unlike what we see a lot today with DVD releases. So it was basically just some stuff that they kind of tagged onto the DVD, some extras, extended scenes, outtakes, and really nothing more than that, where there was like no behind-the-scenes documentary or anything like that that sometimes you get
with
DVDs being released today. And so that's kind of evident on this set.
Well, I'm really glad that you fleshed that out, because I went and tried to do a little bit of research online to find out if I was missing something, because I felt that the extras on this particular disc were, I'm going to say disappointing, not specifically the extras themselves, but the quantity of them. And yeah, there was no behind the scenes, there was no current interview with the stars or the writers or anything that To Entertain tends to put on their discs. I was a little disappointed with that. But just quick rundown, like you mentioned, there's a trailer for episodes 1 and 2. There's extended and deleted scenes, which are interesting. However, the video quality is rather poor on them, but I think the scenes played out well. I can see why they cut, certain ones. There's also a behind the scenes which shows them actually shooting one of the studio scenes with two of the villains and Perry, I think, when she's captive one of the many times. And then there's the audio commentary by Colin Baker, Nicola Bryant, and Nabil Shaban. I'm probably just totally ripping his name to shreds, and I apologize for that. But he's the actor who played Syl. And this, to me, was the diamond in the whole thing, because I've never met Colin Baker. I've never met Nicola Bryant. I have spoken to her. She had a MySpace page. And a year or so ago, I had a MySpace page. And sent her a message, and she was very kind and wrote me back, and she dubbed me her Tennessee friend, you know, here in the U.S. And we did email back and forth a couple of times. She was very, very sweet to do that. And so that sort of gives me an idea of the kind of person that she is. But even more so, listening to the commentary, there's that camaraderie that I've mentioned before on my show that I really, really embrace when I hear two actors who, you know, can sit down like old friends and watch what's going on and comment on it, or even if they go off on a little tangent, they're in sync. There's that click, you know, the chemistry is there. Even if it wasn't written correctly on screen, and I don't know that the Doctor and Perry had great chemistry at this point, but the actors themselves do. So, and maybe that's because of the course of time and doing conventions together and that sort of thing. I don't know. But it did give me a little more insight into Colin Baker, the man, and Colin Baker, the actor, you know, removed from being the Doctor. And so I encourage any of you out there, if you have the DVD or you're going to buy it, listen to the commentary, even if it's not normally your thing. Turn it on and listen to it. There's some great insight into not only the production, but just the people behind, you know, who's on the screen. So I enjoyed it. Did you listen to it, Lewis?
Yeah, I always enjoy the commentary. It's really what makes the DVD shine, you know, outside of the main story, that is. And it's always interesting, especially when you have, like, Colin Baker, and you can see the chemistry that Colin and Nicola have together and how they're playing off each other in the commentary. And you know, and there was one point where Nicola was telling a story about her belt was stolen, and so she was saying, "See, you can see it right there, the belt." And Colin's like, "I'm not looking at the belt."
Well, Colin, you're not alone, buddy. That's why she was always up there on my companion list, you know.
So it's just stuff like that, you know, where their chemistry really shines. And if you do see Colin Baker at a convention, and I think he, you know, he's great seeing on his own, but I always think that he excels when he's with someone else to kind of play off of each other, someone else from Doctor Who. Some of my fondest memories of Doctor Who conventions was with Colin Baker and with Patrick Troughton and John Pertwee together.
Wow.
The three of them would really go off and entertain you to, and you'll be literally rolling on the floor laughing. I mean, it was just incredible stuff, the way the chemistry of those three together in the room. You're bound to have a great time.
And it's such a shame that, you know, we'll never get, like, for me, I've never been to a Doctor Who convention yet, but I do plan on going this year to, or actually, I guess I should say next year, to Gallifrey.
Oh, excellent.
And I already got the go from
that. That would be great. There's another podcaster there. We had this year, we were there with Radio Free Scaro and Behind the Sofa and Tachyon TV. So we had a great time doing that convention, where we had done our live show once before, but this time we had a podcasting panel and we had them together. So having you there would be excellent.
Yeah, I would love to do it, and just to enjoy listening to the stars and to the, you know, production team members and everybody else who's, you know, really who everyone is going to see, and having that. But boy, what a treat to be able to remember that you saw, you know, John Pertwee, Patrick Troughton, because, you know, unfortunately they've left us already. And so, you know, these actors are all, you know, I know you and Ken mention this all the time, you know, we're losing all these great actors as they get older, and that's part of life. But, you know,
that's why these commentaries on these DVDs are so important. And that's why I'm anxious to get more DVDs out there, and, you know, so we can get these recorded commentaries on there.
Yes.
There was one that was, I think, of, if I'm not mistaken, was with Anthony Anley, that was, you know, released recently or somewhat recently, that was obviously recorded before his death. And
I think it was his last story. And I think there was a commentary and he was included on that. I think that's right.
That's why it's important to get these actors together and do these commentaries. And, you know, that's why, not just with our podcast, but with any Doctor Who podcast, you know, it's important to have interviews with these people so that you can get this stuff recorded and you know, for future generations.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Now, there's another audio option on here called production audio. I don't know if you listened to it. I turned it on and started going through the opening credits, and I couldn't hear anything. I mean, it just sounded like I was confused whether or not I actually had it on. I'm going back and forth, and I'm pretty technical, but I couldn't get it.
Yeah, I think it's just a bad terminology. I think what they mean, production audio, meaning that was the option to hear it, you know, without the commentary. In other words, as it went out, the production audio. So I think that's what it meant. They should just have commentary on and off instead of.
Well, and they did. They had the commentary. As far as I know, I think the commentary.
Yeah, they did, and then they had that other. I think it was just a bad layout on the options for the CD. I don't think there is anything. You know, I think it just means. I mean, unless I'm wrong too, I think it just means it's the audio of the production itself.
Well, I got a listener, John. He goes by Hypocaust out in the UK. John will call me out on that if I'm wrong. Darth Skeptical will get me. One of you guys. So if we have missed something, please write in and let me know. Or blame Lewis. That's, you know, he's got broad shoulders. He can take it. The info text is on there, which is always great. I love turning that on. I joke sometimes that they go, you know, into a little too much detail about, you know, that John was supposed to be wearing a purple shirt in this scene, but we moved it to a green because of some, you know, I don't care about that. But it is still interesting to read it. And, you know, while you're watching it, I usually watch it without, and then I'll go back and watch it with just to see what it adds to it, you know, kind of thing. So that's on there. There's a photo gallery. There's a who's who. There's some outtakes. I found the outtakes were sort of limited. There really wasn't anything of note on that. So I'm glad you explained why the DVD extras just weren't quite up to snuff. I mean, if I was reviewing the DVD as a package, including extras, not just story, that would weigh against, you know, how many Cloister Bells I would give it. But
yeah, the minimum extras, and there's no Easter eggs either. If you're looking for Easter eggs, at least not that I found.
I did not find any Easter eggs either. And we're just coming out of Easter was really here, so I'm really good at it because I got up some practice looking for real Easter eggs. So I thought I was on my game, and there weren't any there. But all right, well. That brings us to the close of this review on Vengeance on Varos, or I guess I should say Varos. I keep pronouncing that wrong, but Louis Trapani, thank you so much.
Thank you.
You don't know what it means for me, who has been listening to you since you guys started, to have you on the show. It's like validation, you know, for those of you out there.
Well, and I think you're planning on getting Ken on board too, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, as a matter of fact, next episode I am going to be reviewing Inferno, the third Doctor story, because one of my listeners called me out for not reviewing a six or a third. So I'm doing Inferno, and the plan right now is to have Mr. Ken Deep on with me. So I am excited about that as well.
So, I'm sure he'll offer a lot of insight there, too. I think we reviewed that a while ago.
Oh, did you? Great. Yeah, he wanted to do, like, a first Doctor story, like the Sensorites, but that's only on VHS, and I'm trying to limit myself to the DVD releases. So until that one comes out, I may call him back for that one or something like that. But anyway, until next time, folks, don't forget the website. Again, it's whoonwho.com. Don't forget Avatar Idol. Get out there on the forum section and take a look. There's a wonderful Dave Hingley rendition of Simon Cowell on there with the Avatar Idol icon. It's worth dropping by. Shoot me an email at david@whoonwho.com. I'd love to hear from you. I appreciate you taking time out of your busy lives to listen to this little thing that I do called a podcast. And Lewis, you're, of course, available at podshock.net. And
yes.
GallifreyanEmbassy.org. For the one or two of you out there who don't know about it, go there. If you want to know anything about Doctor Who, especially Doctor Who new series, these guys are it. They are, like I said, they are the high water mark. So go there and they won't leave any stone unturned. So again, thank you very much for being on the show with me today, and I will see everyone next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Cheers.